Hello, it's Scott Manley here with a very interesting test rig here. What I have is four solid rocket boosters. Now, two of them have the landing gear from aircraft attached to them. One is deployed, one is not deployed, and this one has a bunch of random stuff attached to it. We have ladders and struts and pipes and lights and radars and little bits and pieces here. This is to demonstrate something which you may not know about. So I'm just going to launch these and then switch to them. Now the thing to notice is they're all flying at exactly the same speed. Despite this one having a bunch of stuff on it, it's traveling the same speed as the unencumbered one. In fact, the unencumbered one overheats and explodes. Also, whether the landing gear is up or down, out or deployed or not deployed, these things are accelerating at the same rate. Though, so what all this got in common is that these parts are all physicsless, right? There are a number of parts in the game which essentially don't count towards mass or drag in the stock game. That's not to say that they don't count towards drag or mass when you have perhaps Ferrum Aerospace installed, but these default parts, they don't do anything. So adding these parts to your ships will not increase the mass. So, you know, there's a lot of interesting things to do with these. Let's take a look at those. Well, the first thing I'd like to point out is that if you have the standard capsules, they all contain monopropellant, as there was a moment where they thought they were going to make all the Kerbals require these, but then they changed that. So now we're left with capsules that have a little bit of extra fuel in them, and normally it isn't used. But if you stick RCS thrusters on here, then of course those RCS thrusters, they are physicsless, right? They do not add to the mass, they do not add to your ultimate vehicle weight, but once you have deployed the capsule completely, once you have dropped everything else, this thing will still have fuel and enable you to maneuver it in space. You can exploit this to get yourself a little bit extra delta V, and of course, in the new version, they have the monopropellant engines. Now, bizarrely, I would say, the monopropellant engines do not have physics enabled at this time, and This might change, but at this time, the monopropellant engines, they don't add mass. So this does lead to a very interesting bit of physics, let's say. Okay, now you might have built something stupid like this in the past, and when you enable infinite fuel, you essentially get ridiculous accelerations, which is pretty cool. Now if I right-click on this little seismic accelerator, I can actually see how many Gs I'm pulling, and I'm accelerating at about 6 or 7 Gs, but that's largely because I'm inside the atmosphere, and the atmosphere is slowing me down. Now, as we ascend through the atmosphere and the atmospheric drag is removed, our acceleration increases all up to almost, just over 30 Gs, I guess, by the looks of things. 31! Yeah, we top out at about 30 Gs. Because that's essentially constrained by the thrust to mass ratio of this engine, which has a pretty good thrust to mass ratio. So I did a video a while back called the Mooner Express Cheats Challenge, and I challenged people to figure out the fastest way to get to the moon and back and put a flag on it. And the winning entries were, you know, under 10 minutes. So the way you did it wasn't with the giant engines, it was with the Sepetrons. Now the Sepetrons, when they are, you know, launched initially, their thrust to mass ratio is okay, but when they are empty, their thrust to mass ratio is something like 150 to 1. So if you had a spacecraft made of only Sepetrons and it was empty Sepetrons, then you could get 150 Gs of acceleration out of them. So what you would do is more or less lay them out around your rocket like this, put a few hundred on there, and if you did this an infinite number of times, you would get 150 Gs of acceleration. So here we go, we're ready to launch, and hit. Oh yes, of course, we have to enable infinite fuel. And off we go, once again. So let's see what the G-meter tells me on this. It says 20 Gs, but of course we're still 10 kilometers out. We are generating quite a flare here. up to 20 kilometers and, yep, 100 g's of acceleration. But even at 100 g's of acceleration, well, you would still take 3 days to reach the speed of light or thereabouts. So 107g, I could keep adding these things and get up to 150g or get very close, but you can't exceed them with any other parts until now. Okay, so the new engine that was added is the O10 monopropellant engine. That is physicsless. So if I add this to the vehicle, if I add 8 of them, you would imagine that it would add, you know, 8 times 9, it would add roughly 7.72 tons, right? Turns out it doesn't add anything. So if you put these on, and then I'm just going to adjust the rotation to make sure they're firing straight down, that would give you a peak thrust of, well, 20 times 8, that would be 160. But you know what? You can add more, and more, and more, and you can keep adding them. And then you can just keep going as long as you can be bothered. Obviously, landing on these things can be a little dangerous. You can also, of course, duplicate these, and it starts to get a little crazy looking. There, hopefully this will be relatively, these things will be relatively well aligned, because there is no way I'm going to be able to control the rotation of this thing. Let's try launching and see how well this thing goes. So because the mass of the engines is not included, all that's being added is the thrust. So there is no upper limit on the acceleration you can get from this, right? Previously, every time you added an engine, you would add the engine's mass. But this engine doesn't do that. So let's throttle up our engines. We've got infinite fuel enabled. And of course, we're going to bring up our display. 0.995 Gs and... oh, right away, 300 and something G. Unfortunately, we are rotating a little here. It takes a little bit of work to get one that doesn't rotate. But there we go. We're maxing out at about 590. Unfortunately, yeah, this thing will probably spin itself into an early grave. That is quite impressive, I have to say here. Look at it go. Whoa. Spinning around like something crazy. And of course, that thing could actually get to the speed of light in a reasonable amount of time if you could keep it going straight. So yeah, if you want, you can try flying these things to the moon, or you could try doing some other things. And so, this is what I came up with. I decided to make a space probe. 1/10 of the mass, therefore 1/10 of the engines, and 1/10 of the chance of getting them slightly aligned and they're misaligned, and therefore having a space probe that spins itself apart. So I thought, how long is it going to take me to get to Joule? And it turns out that before I got bored of accelerating, I got the ETA down to under 2 hours. And this is more or less me falling towards Joule. Now you'll notice the velocity is actually decreasing. That's probably because it's in surface velocity mode and, you know, the rotation of Joule is being added and therefore is decreasing. Anyway, point is we're moving about 3-4% of the speed of light. This is not time accelerated. This is the real thing that actually greeted me as I flew towards the planet Joule. It was just way fast. You see, I even get an encounter with Tylo for but a second. But here we go. And we bounce off and fly away at about 15 times the speed of light. I did not expect that at all. Look, this is it. Zooming out. There you have. I'm almost back home in but a fraction of a second. It literally shot me back along my initial encounter vector, and the spacecraft was absolutely fine. It was bizarre and cool at the same time. I also thought I'd attempt to set a new runway speed record. The problem with this tends to be staying on the runway. There was a lot of things exploding and flying off at strange velocities and angles. And not all of them in one piece. Now I did think that maybe I could just fly this vehicle very close to the surface and get an estimate of the velocity it would achieve had it been sitting actually on the runway. And you know, we're in the border of the ballpark of like 1200 meters per second before I finally gave up and decided to ditch this. But that gave me an idea for another activity. You see, accelerating in a straight line offers no particular challenges, so I thought, why not try flying in a circle? Specifically, how fast can you fly around the planet Kerbin? If you use infinite fuel, and if you have whatever stock parts available. The trick here is that I'm traveling at roughly 15,000 meters up, and you see I'm moving at 12 kilometers per second. Now, that is much faster than orbital velocity, so instead of wanting to get pulled down by gravity, instead I'm having to point my nose down so I don't fly off into space. And as I fly up higher in the atmosphere, the drag drops and my velocity rises and I need to nose down even more. And somewhere in there is a balance where you can go stupidly fast and stay in orbit around Kerbin. It's really cool to watch the sky zipping around here. It's almost like a time acceleration or something here. Unfortunately, this is all in the night side, but you can see some stuff flying around. Just wait until daylight arises. There we go, there's the sun. And oh, I'm getting altitude a little quickly here. Look at how fast that is going. This is ridiculous. And yeah, I think at this point I started to really go too high and too fast, so I have to I'm now at 30 kilometers per second. Look at this thing. It's ridiculous. Flying over the desert. Like, way too fast now. Point my nose totally down. And, oh, just keeping some control here, but also picking up speed. This is a great challenge. So, the question is, how fast can you fly around Kerbin in this vehicle? Or any vehicle? And I guess the challenge is leave from the space center, arrive back at the space center, and have the minimum amount of time on the clock. Now, even if the developers do fix the physics significance flag for these engines, there will still be a bunch of parts that you can use, but a word of warning to you. Physicsless parts exist in a strange kind of grey area in the physics engine, and sometimes they behave in strange ways. Such as this little rover, which is entirely constructed from physicsless parts. As I start to roll along, you see it's starting to shake a little. It has the old shimmy, the Kraken is getting in on the act. And we all know how this ends. So respect these parts, and use their powers for awesome. I'm Scott Manley, fly safe.